wherever that you wanna go. I'm going up the country, baby, don't you wanna go. I'm going to some place where I've never been before.
Welcome to the third annual Golden Crocodile Award.
That's right, the most prestigious award in creationism is here again. It's time for the coveted Golden Crocoduck 2010.
Forever, heaven is a place where nothing ever happens.
When a Creatard achieves a Golden Crocoduck Award from Potholder 54, I guess there's just not that much more I can say except salute! Congratulations, Neffy. I can't think of anyone who deserves it more. I kind of feel Neffy owes me a little thank you for prompting him to produce some of the finest examples of brain dead, knuckle dragging, creatard fuck nuttery on YouTube this year. Not that I'm going to be waiting on Neffy's call. But I believe with the Golden Crocoduck Award, my work is finished with Neff. It's time I moved on. But not to worry, because I know a whole new crop of creatards that I'll be pwning in the near future. Before I leave, though, I wanted to clear up one final question that NephilimFree asked me recently. Neffy posed a question to me concerning something he called the Cretaceous layer. I made a joke about it involving chicken, but I must admit to have been a bit bemused because to me, Cretaceous is an entire system, a stratigraphic column of rocks representing the Cretaceous period, which ran from about 145 million years ago to 65 million years ago. But in checking a bunch of creatard websites, I found out when they talk about Cretaceous layers, they're talking about the late Cretaceous chalks, which after all, give the Cretaceous its name. Creta is Latin for chalk. As a matter of fact, the geologic symbol for the Cretaceous is K, and that comes from the German word Kreide, which means chalk. These creatard websites talk about the Cretaceous chalks as if it's a deep geologic mystery, and that it somehow supports their flood myth. Apparently, they haven't read in geologic literature for the last 25 years, because that mystery was solved quite some time ago. And that's what this video is about. Now, the first thing I need to explain about chalk is that it's almost pure calcium carbonate. In other words, it's not contaminated with a lot of silt and sand and stuff washed off the continents and into the ocean basins. And it's extracted from seawater by some little microorganisms called coccolithophores. And these lived abundantly in Cretaceous sea. At any given time, there were billions of these little microorganisms living their planktonic lives in the Cretaceous seas. And as they died, their tiny little calcareous skeletons would slowly descend and eventually settle on the ocean floor. If one could go back in time and go down in a deep submersible and watch the action, it would be like a constant, gentle snowfall of these tiny little skeletons. The only real question is, why were these coccolithophores so abundant in late Cretaceous seas? And for that, we need to look at the Cretaceous world, a world quite different from the one we're used to. A number of factors led to the explosion of coccolithophores in the late Cretaceous, and these had to do with climate, geography, plate tectonism, and ocean chemistry. Let's start with a brief look at Cretaceous geography. From the beginnings of the Cretaceous up until about 75 million years ago, world climate continued to get warmer, and sea level continued to rise, so that low-lying areas of continents by about 90 million years ago were flooded by shallow seas. It was in these shallow epicontinental seas that the vast chalk layers were laid down. Enormous reef systems formed on the margins of these epicontinental seas, but unlike today's reef systems, these were not dominated by corals. Instead, they were dominated by a bizarre and now extinct group of plesiopods called rutas. And here's a map showing the zone in which these reefs occurred. Throughout the Cretaceous, world climate was much milder than today, and temperatures continued to increase throughout the Cretaceous up until about 75 million years ago. During that period of chalk accumulation, 90 to 75 million years ago, it's thought that world temperatures were on average about 10 degrees centigrade higher than today. And perhaps you're wondering how that number is arrived at. Well, of course, the fossil record gives us a general indication that climate was milder in the Cretaceous because of the distribution of fossil plant and animal species. For example, fossil trees have been found in Antarctica. Fossil crocodilians have been found in northern Canada and Alaska. Fossil dinosaurs, amphibians, and so forth have been found in Australia at a time when Australia was not far from the South Pole. More directly, the temperature of ocean water can be determined with reasonable certainty by looking at the chemistry of fossil shells. That's because the ratio of two oxygen isotopes, oxygen 16 to oxygen 18, are temperature dependent in seawater. And organisms that construct calcium carbonate shells derive the oxygen from the seawater, and they incorporate the ratio in seawater at the time they lived. An examination of the calcareous shells of marine organisms from all over the world that lived during the Late Cretaceous indicate that seawater was relatively depleted in oxygen 18, and this indicates that the temperature of seawater was quite high. As a matter of fact, a generalized map of world temperatures can be constructed. Now back to all that Cretaceous chalk. I want to talk about a couple of grand cycles throughout geologic history. For the last billion years or so, the Earth has fluctuated between an ice house world, like the one we're living in today with permanent ice caps at the poles, and sometimes with vast continental glaciers, and a greenhouse world in which there's no permanent ice cap and very little glaciation throughout the world. And that long-term fluctuation between ice house and greenhouse is reflected, as I alluded earlier, by the oxygen 16 to oxygen 18 ratios in seawater, as indicated by the calcareous shells of organisms living at various times in geologic history. There is also a long-term mineralogic fluctuation that touches on our question about the chalk, and this fluctuation tracks very well with the fluctuation of climate between ice house and greenhouse. Calcium carbonate actually comes in two mineral forms, calcite and aragonite. Chemically, they're exactly the same, but their mineral structures are different and they form under somewhat different conditions. In the relatively cool waters of an ice house world, calcium carbonate in the form of aragonite tends to predominate in the world's oceans, and organisms that synthesize aragonite as their shells tend to become dominant marine species. Conversely, in the warm tropical waters of a greenhouse world, species that synthesize calcite tend to predominate. With regard to the Cretaceous chalks, it was this greenhouse world combined with relatively high sea levels providing a vast favorable habitat for these little coccolithophores that allowed for the formations of gigantic chalk deposits. Alrighty guys, I hope you don't mind. I was a little more serious, a little more sciencey with this one. I guess it's because I, Pilgrim Pater, Potholder 54, and a host of other people have already pwned Nephi within an inch of his life. And I did want to talk about the Cretaceous because it's a fascinating period and a strange, strange world. I've only hit the highlights here, so I'm going to give you some reference material if you want to do more reading. And next time, I want to go back in time just a little bit further to the middle of the Cretaceous to talk about black shale and most of the world's valuable petroleum resources. Until then, bis später.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of tomorrow, just you wait and see.
Thank you.